Hello, I'm Dr. April Massey, Dean of the College of Arts and Sciences, and your host for a new interview series, Talking Arts and Sciences. Over the course of this series, you will hear the candid and unscripted insights of administrators, professors, students, and guest lecturers who are involved in programs and activities that allow our graduates to aspire, accomplish, and take on the world. Today's program focuses on regional accreditation. Accreditation is an important barometer of the university's effectiveness, its ability to persist in adding value to the lives of its students, and a hallmark of its competitiveness nationally and internationally. The University of the District of Columbia is regionally accredited by the Middle States Commission on Higher Education. Joining me to talk about the university's recent reaccreditation process is my colleague, Dr. Lena Walton. Dr. Walton is the Associate Dean for Academic Affairs in the University of the District of Columbia's College of Arts and Sciences. Welcome, Dr. Walton.
Thank you for having me.
So, you spent the last year and a half of your professional life shepherding the university through one of its most critical processes. Can you, for our audience, just give us in a nutshell what regional accreditation is, a regional accreditation 101?
Okay, so regional accreditation is when the university takes a look at itself, does a self-evaluation, does a reflection of itself, and reports that to the regional accreditation body, which for the University of the District of Columbia, it's the Middle States Commission on Higher Education. Okay. We do this introspection, we do this reflection based on standards that the commission has. And so we take each of those standards and we look at ourselves to see how we're measuring against those standards.
So for the student or the prospective student who's considering UDC, what does a positive nod from the regional accreditor mean for that student? So what does it say about UDC relative to all of the other institutions who are in the Middle States region?
Okay, the UDC, if a person is planning to come to the University of the District of Columbia, and if I were planning to come to the University of the District of Columbia, I would first look to see if the institution and its and relevant programs are accredited. Mm-hmm. When an institution is accredited, it actually allows the public to have more confidence in what the university is doing, because the university is measuring itself against a standard set of standards, a set of standards that have been identified as best practice for any higher education institution. And so if a person is looking at an institution that is accredited, then it gives that person more confidence in coming to the institution and in knowing that the institution will provide the kind of education that is of the highest quality.
So in the DC metropolitan region, Middle States reaccreditation for UDC is the same set of standards that American University was held
Absolutely.
To, Georgetown University, George Washington University, Catholic University,
Howard
Trinity,
yes.
And Trinity had a visit the week before we had a
Just
visit.
Just before we had a visit.
So it's important for the viewing audience to know that the standards of the regional accreditor apply to everyone in the region similarly.
Yes.
So there's no. So can you talk about that just a little bit in terms of just that there are, we came up against 14 standards.
Yes, we were measured against 14 standards, and those 14 standards look at everything across the university. Mm-hmm. It looks at the 14 standard look at first of all, what is our mission, vision, and goal. Mm-hmm. It looks at the integrity of the institution. Mm-hmm. It looks at student learning. It looks at how we provide the services to the students in order for them to be successful once they walk through the doors, or even before they walk through the door. What is it that we're providing for the student? And every university has to reflect on themselves to make sure that they are accomplishing this. Now, every university has a different set of goals and objectives for themselves, and their mission is different. And so when they're looking at the 14 standards and looking at how they are providing the kind of education that their mission says they're providing, so the University of the District of Columbia is no different than George Washington University, for example. Their mission is different than the University of the District of Columbia, but we are measured against the same standards. How are we meeting our mission? What are the services that we're providing for students in order to make them successful citizens of the District of Columbia or the region or the world? How are we allocating resources so that we are meeting our mission and goals? Mm-hmm. Every university has to do that, and every university has to be accountable based on those 14 standards.
Mm-hmm. So we had a Middle States team on campus the first week of April, and that visit was the culminating component of a couple of years of preparation. Mm-hmm. So talk a little bit about the outcome. What happened?
Can I just say that it wasn't a couple of years of preparation, it was 10 years of preparation. Yes. It was actually 10 years. But within the last 2 years, we actually did the reflective part of it and did the evaluation part of it so that we could write a report to say how we think we were doing. So your question is, how did it go for us in this accreditation cycle? Well, we accomplished all 14 standards. We met all 14 standards, and I dare say this is a preliminary report. This was a preliminary report. We are waiting for the final report, so in another few weeks we will have the final report. But so far we had 11 commendations, and we are very excited because this is a new starting point for us where we are going to be moving forward to take care of all the recommendations that we had, the recommendations we gave ourselves for being a better, more robust institution.
Mm-hmm. Talk about the commendations. What areas did the team say, you know what, you guys are doing not just a good job, but an extraordinary job in these places? Can you talk a little bit about those 11 commendations?
I can talk about a few of them. I didn't commit all 11 to memory, but the overall for our integrity, where we are making sure that the university community and the community at large know what we're doing, know what we're about, and we follow all our policy and procedures.
Yes.
We were commended for the our goals and objectives and the mission of the university, and that it seemed to be meeting the requirements of the District of Columbia and its residents. We were commended for our work in assessment, that assessment is a grassroots process here at UDC. Everybody does assessment, and then it bubbles up, and the information is used to make decisions about where we go next. Those were some of the main areas that we were very happy that we had commendations from those, for those.
You said an important thing about the self-study process, that as a part of the work that we do, we actually make recommendations for our own improvement. Talk a little bit about the things that we saw as a campus, as a community, that we said, you know, we're doing okay here, but we can do better by examining these things and challenging ourselves to reach beyond these places. Mm-hmm. Can you talk a little bit about the recommendations that we made for ourselves?
Okay, I think one of the first things that come to mind, because it's so near and dear to my own thoughts, is general education. We saw that we were doing good in the area of general education, providing a very robust program, a cutting edge program, but we felt that we need to do some more work in terms of organizing ourselves around our transfer students, the students coming from multiple universities coming into ours, and making sure that our general education program does not affect their time to graduation. Mm-hmm. So we had we recommended for ourselves to take a deeper look at that. Yes. Although we were commended on our assessment or work with assessment, we also recommended for ourselves that we have an area or an office that deals with assessment. So it's an oversight for the entire university that will ensure that when assessments are done in one area, that it bubbles into another another office. So for example, if a member of faculty assesses their course, then the course, the assessment of the course needs to speak to what the program does and whether or not the program is measuring up to nationally what that program looks like or the standards for that program. And so, you know, we recommended that we have that office that every day is in the trenches with the faculty, with the staff, working on assessments and ensuring that the outcomes from those assessments, the recommendations, are used effectively to enhance student learning at the university. We made so many different recommendations, but those are the ones that come to mind right now for us going forward.
Okay. We talked a bit about an important part of regional accreditation is that it says that you have met a standard that your peers around you have met. And so it is an important part of marketing your institution because you show yourself to be equally strong in terms of the basics of the accreditation standards to your peers. Mm-hmm. But there's another piece around financial aid that mm-hmm. regional accreditation has an important implication for. Mm-hmm. And that's particularly important for us given the number of students that enroll here who are Pell Grant eligible. Mm-hmm. But with the increases in costs of college education, many students are requiring financial aid in the way of loans mm-hmm. to be able to manage the cost of a college education. Mm-hmm. So can you talk a bit about the financial aid implications of regional accreditation?
All universities that are accredited are able, the students in that university are able to take advantage of federal financial aid. Mm-hmm. If we do not become accredited, then the university would not, the students would not be allowed to participate in federal financial aid the way they are doing currently. Mm-hmm. So that was a part of the evaluations as well. How are we serving our students in terms of educating them about financial aid? How mm-hmm. are we serving our students in terms of advising them about the financial aid process, how to make the applications, and what they should or shouldn't be doing in order to be eligible for their financial aid? Accreditation affects everything about an institution. It affects everything. So if an institution is not accredited or if they lose their accreditation, they have to go through a series of processes and sometimes eventually have to close their doors. And it's not a short term or whenever an institution loses accreditation, it doesn't close its door the very next day. There is a process that the institution has to go through over time to close its doors, if it has to close its doors. And this process would be supervised by the commission. And then eventually the doors of the institution is closed and the students have to be taught out, they have to be referred to other institutions to complete their programs. The faculty would no longer be in the institution, the staff, everyone would be affected by not earning accreditation.
And across the country, unfortunately, we've seen a number of programs who have gone by the wayside because they've not been able to meet the standards of their regional accreditors. Mm-hmm. As you, in the last 2 years, have shepherded the process of self-study, what did you find? Because you've looked in every nook and cranny of the institution.
Yeah.
And you've come to know offices that you probably didn't have a need to have as intimate a relationship with before. Mm-hmm. What did you find that surprised you?
I wouldn't say surprised me. I learned a lot. As a member of faculty and then as an administrator in the College of Arts and Sciences, I never thought about the process of the process behind the scenes of, for example, doing a budget, mm-hmm. or submitting a budget to the city council or to the mayor. Mm-hmm. I did not think about that. I didn't think about the only things I thought about were the things that were directly impacting what I do, yes. and impacting me. So I learned a great deal about what happens that we're not even aware of, mm-hmm. that is impacting us daily, and we don't know that they're happening. Right. I learned about some of the reasons why we're having difficulty standing up some programs. Mm-hmm. I learned about, mm-hmm. The Title IV process. Yes. There are just so many things that we do not think about. The other thing that I learned about in doing this, and which the public now has access to, is that every university needs to have a page that is titled Students Need to Know, or Students' Right to Know. And it's not just students, it's students, families, prospective students, their right to know things about the university. And that information needs to be there in order for us to be in compliance with the U.S. Department of Education and to be in compliance with the commission. And so now I know that sometimes I look on the internet and I look on our website for information, mm-hmm. and it's there or it's not there, and it didn't make a difference to me because it wasn't that impactful. But now that we've gone through this process, and I've said it to all the constituencies of the university, these things need to be there. Students need to know how to calculate their fees. Students need to know what happens if I don't pass a course. Students need to know a lot of stuff, and that is another thing that I learned in this mm-hmm. process. But as I said, it wasn't anything surprising, mm-hmm. or it wasn't surprises. Maybe I wasn't looking for surprises, but it was things that I did not know, and I would not have known had I not been in this process.
So as you uncovered some of those things. Mm-hmm. Talk about the process of weaving the story, because at the end of the period of self-evaluation, there's you piece together a document that really mm-hmm. is the university story. Mm-hmm. So talk about the insertion of all of those pieces into a story. I mean, and that story becomes published document that's mm-hmm. available to the community, mm-hmm. and so it has to be written in language that makes the story available to the community. Talk about weaving the story and actually committing that to paper and walking away with a document that lives. I mean, mm-hmm. the reaccreditation process for that 10-year period is complete, but we're not finished with accreditation. No. It lives.
Right.
And so can you talk a little bit about weaving that story into the pages in mm-hmm. that book, really, that right. you ended up with?
Okay, before I talk about the process, the weaving the story together, I want to acknowledge all the people who worked on that mm-hmm. particular document. There was a committee, a standing committee for the university that had several members from all constituencies of the university, and three co-chairs that worked together to put the document together, plus numerous other people from across the university that touch that document in some way, shape, or form, including yourself. yes, but the story that we told or we tried to get across to the general public is that the institution is evolving, mm-hmm. that we have a mission, we have a current mission, we have a mission and goals and objectives. Mm-hmm. We have statutory responsibilities because we are in part three statutory organizations wove us together. Mm-hmm. So we have the land grant piece,
yes.
We're an HBCU, mm-hmm. and we're a state university.
Yes.
And so each of those three statutory responsibilities that we have make us into an institution that in some ways is unique because of what we do, mm-hmm. and in other ways we're answering to each of the areas. Mm-hmm. And so as higher education evolves, we're evolving, but we stay within our three major statutory sets of responsibilities. Mm-hmm. The other piece of the story is that in our evolution, we evolved in several ways. We're evolving because of our programs. Mm-hmm. We're evolving because our student body is evolving. Mm-hmm. We're evolving because our administration evolves.
Right.
We're evolving with our consistent work with the district government,
yes.
in order to meet the needs of the district.
Mm-hmm.
And we're evolving because the citizens of the District of Columbia, that group is evolving.
Absolutely.
And we're the state institution, so we have to evolve with our state constituencies. And so the story is about the evolution of the university, where we were, what we have done in the 10 years, and the work that we put in, where is it taking us? And how are we, some of the ways that we're thinking that we would get to that point.
Mm-hmm.
So basically the 105 pages actually go through a storyline, mm-hmm. of evolution. And at each point of this evolution, we take assessments, and we look at what we've done well, what we need to do better, and we make recommendations to ourselves to move to the next level.
Okay. So the standards for accreditation are evolving as well.
Yes.
And so what had been a 10-year process,
mm-hmm.
now becomes an 8-year process.
Yes.
But there's a change in the annual report out. Am I correct?
Yes. So the commission has, I think over the past 2 years, they have been talking about the changes to the standards. We're going from 14 standards to 8 standards.
Mm-hmm.
The standards, I think they have been approved by the commission.
Okay.
And this was a regional, they shopped it out to all, mm-hmm. the universities and groups and discussed it, and they've approved eight standards.
Okay.
The standards look very different. They have the basic undertone, but mm-hmm. the major thread that runs through all of the standards is student learning. So whatever,
okay.
we do in all aspects of the university, one of the major considerations is how are we impacting student learning?
Mm-hmm.
So the person who is at the front desk taking your questions about admissions,
yes.
they are impacting student learning.
Mm-hmm.
And so that will be the major focus of the new set of standards. It is student learning. And our next accreditation cycle will come up in 8 years.
Mm-hmm.
And when we respond to those 8 standards, we will be, when we respond in the next 8 years, we will be responding to 8 standards, 8. So in the interim, they're also piloting the new reporting system,
mm-hmm.
with a group of universities across the region. And okay. so once that, once they've approved the new reporting processes, then we will get the process and procedures for the reporting. But from what I understand, it will be an annual reporting process. And because they're piloting now, we have 2 years to wait for our first annual report. Okay. So it we never stop. And right. you know, accreditation it helps the public to right. understand what we're doing.
Right.
But it also it the bigger piece is that it helps us.
Right.
So we're working for our students, we're working for our community, and therefore we are consistently reviewing, revising, reflecting, and evaluating what we do.
Okay. So I want to thank you. I think that because of your leadership in the self-study process, not only were we successful, and successful I don't mean by just saying that we had a positive outcome, I think we were successful because you shepherded a process that made us dig deep mm-hmm. and do the work of understanding where we were significantly strong, where we were okay, and where we could grow. And I think that because you led the process in that way, when the self-study team exited the campus, you made it very clear to us that the process of self-study didn't exit with them. And
Absolutely.
So we are in a continuous loop of self-discovery, self-improvement.
Yes.
So I want to thank you for joining me today. I look forward to the work that we have ahead of us. I think because of the process that you shepherded, that work is much less daunting for the community. So I just want to say thank you publicly, because I think that it was an amazing effort that you ran.
Thank you for having me. And again, I have to acknowledge that the entire university was a part of this process.
I understand.
Yes.
I understand. So if you would like more information about the academic programs and events offered by the University of the District of Columbia College of Arts and Sciences, please visit us at www.udc.edu. Thank you for watching. I am April Massey, Dean of the College of Arts and Sciences at the University of the District of Columbia. Our hashtag is Your Dream, Our Guidance.